this topic that I chose was chosen about a month ago before what's currently happening right now in Israel. And I needed to make a topical segue before we actually go into talking about Ilan Ramon and talking about what his mission was, what he stood for. Because Ilan Ramon's mission was more than just the mission of an individual traveling into space. It was a mission for the Jewish people, it was a mission for the Jewish state, it was a mission for our homeland. And he had a lot to tell us. And the most important lesson he had to tell us was all Jews are responsible one for the other. And right now, we understand once again that in our own homeland, there is a situation right now where Jews once again are being hunted, but it's nothing new. Ilan Ramon was very conscious of his role as a son and grandson of Holocaust survivors and as a colonel in the Israeli Air Force, of just how far we have come. Just imagine, Ilan Ramon came from a family where both his mother and grandmother were liberated from Auschwitz, two generations. And 70 years later, here we are today. Yes, Jews have been hunted, Jews have always been hunted. The big difference is now that we're in charge of our own destiny. Ilan Ramon, basically, if you can imagine, just in January this year, I was privileged to be guiding a very, very special group. I took a bunch of Holocaust survivors from Israel to Auschwitz for the 70th anniversary commemoration ceremony. And we were actually making a documentary for the Shoah Foundation. So Steven Spielberg was also part of the group as well. And we had all these survivors. Many of them had never been back since they were liberated as children 70 years previously. And one particular moment that stood out is that we had the state ceremony, which really lacked a Yiddish in the Shabbat. There was no hatikvah, there was no cabbage, there was no kermel rachamim. And many survivors felt that they were, and their families, they were accompanied by their children and grandchildren, they wanted to make just a little bit more Jewish. So I suggested we walk along the tracks to the blown up crematoria and we have our own little ticket to come on the memorial ceremony there. And as we were walking in the snow and the ice and freezing cold with all our layers on and hand warmers, people probably imagine what it must have been like wearing striped pajamas and clogs. And everyone was very much huddled down and thinking their own thoughts. I heard the sound of people. I looked up and saw a delegation from the Israeli Air Force heading our way. And it was a group called Edim Lamadim, witnesses in uniform, where the Israeli Army Officers School sends promising cadets to Poland so they can learn two things, what it meant not to have a Jewish state and what importance it is to have a Jewish state. So I heard this group speaking in the room. I looked up and saw a whole bunch of Air Force officers. And I saw the moon glinting off the moonlight glinting off the Star of David in their cap badges. And I said to them, do you mind just stopping for a second so we can sing Hatikva together? In this place of death and despair, let us sing a song of hope and let us remember how fortunate we are to be living in this generation. And we did, and together the survivors and their children and grandchildren and the Israeli Air Force officers sang together. It made me think that you had to go back 70 years to the time when Ilan, my mom's mother and grandmother were in Auschwitz simply because they were Jewish. And to tell these people, you come from a time 70 years in the future where there is a Jewish state, where there is a Jewish homeland, where Jews once again are in charge of their own destiny, where there are Jewish soldiers and Jewish farmers, where he was the spoken language. What do you think the reaction would have been to those Jews, including my own grandmother's family, I'm sure many of your families as well, to hear those words? Many of them would have probably fallen on their faces thinking we're talking about some kind of messianic era, because after all, this is what Jews yearned and wanted to pray for centuries. Yotam Hoshivak Singh was the hope for 2,000 years to be a few people in our land. Everyone mumbled and shouted out about Yerushalayim, but who really thought it would actually happen? It's just part of the service, part of Seder, part of the Yom Kippur. But here we are. We live in a tremendous time, in a time of which it's in the capital of Tenu, at the beginning of our redemption. And most importantly, we live in a time when Jews can actually respond, not just be victims. We live in a time of miracles and wonders. So with everything that's happening in Israel, look where we are now, look where we were then. And that really is what the message of Ilan Ramon's to us. And I think that before we start talking about Ilan Ramon, I wanted to pay tribute to the IDF Israeli soldiers who are defending our homeland. Just yesterday, I was speaking to the Jewish Federation in Minneapolis, and I asked them, there's a whole bunch of Federation people and people from Hillel, what adjectives spring to their mind when I mention the word an IDF soldier? And I'm sure it's very similar adjectives that I would get from you. Courage, bravery, all these adjectives. Then I asked them what adjectives would spring to the mind if I went to United States College campus and ask them, IDF soldier, very different, occupier, murderer, etc., etc. But we need to remember, the reason we can sit here safely today and be proud as Jews is because we're with Israel and Israel's with us. And people ask me now, what can we do? People feel so helpless, so low, so far away. What can we do for Israel? And the most important thing you can do, believe it or not, is to do exactly what Hashem told Abraham, the first inside the first Jew God, which is Abraham. We can all make a commitment now, especially now, to go to Israel. Especially now. By the end of this year, hopefully everyone, by the end of this coming year, everyone should book a ticket. That should be the first thing you can do. Israel needs us, but we need Israel. That's the most important thing you can do. And the reason why we have the state, it's because young boys, young 18-year-old boys and girls, who didn't just rush straight off to college, but rather decided for 2 or 3 years of their lives, they were going to go and give an option to take. It's a beautiful thing. And you know you're old when you look at pictures of Israeli soldiers, you meet them, and you say, wow, they're so young. That's always one of the things. And there's two people in this room, myself and Adam Cohen here, who both served as fighting brothers in the IDF. And now looking at these soldiers, they look so young. So I wanted to start off just as a tribute clip, 1 minute clip to soldiers in my particular unit, which is called Givati. It was made, which is just pictures and adjectives, just so we need to start the day off with Hakarat HaTov and recognizing the fortune of the times that we actually live in. Ilan Ramon's entire life has lived for one thing, one thing only, and that was selfless approach to the Jewish state and the Jewish people, coming from the time that he came from. And take a step back here and talk about the Israeli Air Force. The idea is a phenomenal army, and if you want to volunteer for a combat unit, you can. But there's one unit you can't volunteer for, and that is the Israeli Air Force. Now, my mom was the colonel in the Israeli Air Force. He was head of strategic planning before he was selected to be an astronaut. And one of the reasons you can't volunteer for it is because they have to ask you if you've got the potential to come. Every Israeli, when they finish high school, would love to get a invitation in the post. It's called the Zimun Latai, the Invitation to Triumph of Pilots course. And the people selected to get this invitation are not normal people. They're not people who you and I would say Joe or Jane average. These are exceptional people just to be selected academically, physically, psychologically, mentally, socially, from every point of view. If you ace out on all of these things, then you get a Zimun Latai. You get an invitation to try out. And that does not mean you can go and get cool aviator spectacles and a leather jacket and walk around with cool background music. It doesn't mean you're a pilot. It means you can try out for the course. And the chances of you finishing that course are slim to none. Because only 3% of people actually start the course finishing. 3%. They can literally keep you out of the day before the end of the course. When I was in a kibbutz, adopted as a soldier, as a lone soldier, there was a guy in our kibbutz who was kicked out 2 months before the end of the course. And you don't know why. And one of the reasons why it's so selective is because of sheer financial reasons. Just the airplanes alone. They don't know how much an F-15 costs to fly the bomb. Take a guess. More than day school tuition. That sounds pretty unbelievable. So, $1 million? $1 million, they're going to buy about the back third of the plane for that. It costs $100 million. An F-15 costs $100 million. An F-16, which is what Ilan Ramon was flying in his Iraq mission, is only $80 million. And that's a 4-year that Israel gets it. It strips the entire inside out and puts the whole plane inside with Israeli computer and recognized systems, etc., etc. Just to fly a plane for an hour. Now, no petrol's cheaper in New Jersey than it is in New York. What I saw this morning. A shout to self. Flying an airplane for an hour. Take a wild guess how much it costs to fly a plane for an hour. What? 10,000 would probably get you about 45 minutes of flying time. It's $14,000 an hour to fly an airplane, right? And one last statistic, to train a pilot, every IAF pilot, IAF pilot, actually finishes training, costs $3 million to train a pilot. So you don't want Joe or Jane Schmo driving you a $100 million airplane around, and you just waste $3 million training them. And when they do finish, they have to commit for 7 years in the Air Force, 7 years, which is not as bad as it sounds if anyone's been to the Israeli Air Force trips. I've actually had friends who volunteer. I have a friend who's a mechanic for Apache helicopters. He volunteers to do reserve duty, because A, you get away from the wife with kids, B, he's got a swimming pool there, he's got a table and a snooker, and just amazing, amazing food and great conditions. Oh no, I have to do reserve again. That's the fourth time you're going in the last month. So you have to volunteer for 7 years. And really every, I don't know if you people know this, but every minute of every day, there are airborne planes in Israel. They really are in the eyes of our state. And it's extremely selective. And I'll ask you guys a question. Can women be combat pilots in Israeli Air Force?
Yes. Yes.
They can. Why does one of us ask that question 10 years ago? What would the answer be?
No.
What changed it? First person to apply for the course. I don't know what her name was. How one person can make a difference in history. Okay, so her name, I'm practicing, she was a South African immigrant. Her name was Alice Miller. And she said she already had a civilian pilot's license from South Africa. She was conscripted to the Air Force and said, I want to go to the pilot's course. You can't. She said, why not? Because you're a woman. She said, well, why can't I do it? She said, well, we just don't accept women. So what did she do? She looked at Israel's constitution. What does that say? That's a trick question, right? There is no constitution, right? We're not just one. We have basic laws, we haven't quite got around to a new constitution. We're still working on that one, almost 70 years later. So what would the most important document be in Israel if you don't have a constitution? You want to see one of the rights of people? The Megillat Hatzmaut, the Declaration of Independence, which clearly says, and I quote, I just happen to have a copy on me, it says the following. Again, I quote, and the state of Israel will be based on freedom, justice, and peace as envisioned by the province of Israel, will ensure complete equality of social, political rights to all of its inhabitants, irrespective of religion, race, or sex. So what does she do, this woman who had a tremendous amount of guts, wasn't prepared to stand up? She took the Israeli Air Force to the Supreme Court of Israel. And she said, they will not let me in, and yet here it says clearly, black and white, Shafo al-Gabay Man, complete equality. So they said, she won, by the way, to run the case. And the Air Force said, well, take women in on one condition. What's the condition? If you want equality, what's the condition? Exactly the same training as guys. Now, we're not doing different training for girls, different training for guys. Of course, it's going to be integrated, and it's the same training. And then she got into the course, and she didn't finish. It was not the only company ever after. She was the 97% of people who didn't finish. Even though she had all these attributes, she had the guts, the fiber. No one will know why she didn't finish. But what she did do is she opened the door for females to go in. And the first graduate, the first female fighter pilot, had an amazing story. Her name was Ronit Zuckerman. If anyone studied anything about the Shoah, they'll know that the two leaders of Warsaw Ghetto Revolt, who afterwards founded Kibbutz Lochamei HaGadol, the Ghetto Fighter People in Israel, were Antik Zuckerman and his wife as well, Tuvia Lubetkin. Their granddaughter, the granddaughter of these two people who survived the Warsaw Ghetto Revolt, founded the Ghetto Fighter People in Israel, was the first combat pilot in the Israeli Air Force. And just to show you now that it's not a lone example, just last year, the previous pilots course, of the 21 graduates, 5 of them were female. And just to understand what kind of people they are, we have our next short clip over here.
Can I hit the lights?
This is a woman you do not want to mess with.
Lieutenant N. I fly the F-15I, the best plane in the Israeli Air Force. It's an American plane, of course. Very powerful and expensive. It has two engines, two tails, and it seats two people. It can carry a lot of bombs. It can arrive at very far destinations, and it can protect the states of Israel from very big threats. I joined the Israeli Air Force Academy because it gives a challenge. 3 long, hard years. I didn't think I would pass, but at the end, standing there with the wings on your chest, I felt very proud. Daily routine of a pilot and a squadron is not easy. You have to be ready 24/7 for every mission. The situation can change dramatically. You can one moment sit on the couch and watch TV, and the other you have to run to the plane and be ready to whatever comes. And in the Air Force, we feel responsible for the safety of the people in their homes. The Israeli Air Force treats equally women and men in the squadron. We are doing the same thing, the same job. I'm proud of being here. I'm proud of flying the F-15I in very complicated missions. And the people of Israel can sleep good at night knowing that this squadron exists.
Now we can get on to the point of the actual, of the introduction, what we're actually talking about. I want to focus on one particular pilot, but I'm explaining a bit about the training, I'm explaining a bit about the fortunate times that we live in. Now I want to talk about Ilan Ramon himself, not how he died, but what he lived for. Ilan Ramon was that person who would make everybody sick. Not only was he a jock, he was a nerd, and he married his high school sweetheart, and there's all these things just want to make you want to bark. Basically, he just did everything perfectly, and on top of that, he was humble as well. I actually had the privilege and tremendous support to meet him about 4 months before the mission. We were having a conference with Shlichim in Philadelphia, and they introduced us. This is Ilan Ramon. He's going to be flying a space shuttle in 4 months. He's our first astronaut. And they introduced him. They told us all about the stuff that he'd done, which I'm going to tell you a bit about. And we expected this guy to be swaggering in the room with a leather jacket and everything. No, this small, humble guy came in with a huge smile that just lit up the room. He spoke to us for 20 minutes and never once spoke in the first person. Not once. That's what I remember. It's incredible humility. And that's when you really know that someone's a special person. With all those achievements, he had a lot to be arrogant about. And I've never met such a single person in my life. It's really moving. It made it doubly tragic the fact that I actually met him before. And I couldn't even imagine the loss, not just the result of his own family as well, but they would never let his children grow up that far. Such a special father. So Ilan Ramon did all those things. He was smart. He was an amazing athlete. He was incredibly accomplished. He was a concert level piano player. Everything. And he married his high school sweetheart, I mentioned that before. And no one was surprised when he got his Zygmunt the Tyson. track the course. And nobody was surprised when he finished with the Air Force. That's just like, people just knew that was going to happen. And he got accepted to the Air Force. And he rose up after 7 years, he signed on in the Air Force to stay in the Air Force. By the time 1981 rolls around, he is the co-president in charge of strategic planning of the Israeli Air Force. In 1981, there was a country beginning with I in the Middle East that had just about this close to building a nuclear weapon, and they wanted to wipe out the Zionist entity. What was that country called back then? What?
Iraq.
Iraq, right, it was called Iraq. Now, Iraq was this close. What was the world doing about it? Literally this close. It was weeks away from becoming operational. What was the world doing about it?
Nothing.
No, they were doing, they were talking. Yap, 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 another UN confirmation. And who was the Prime Minister of Israel at the time? Who remembers back in 81? Menachem Begin. And Menachem Begin, who himself had lost direct family members, siblings and parents in the Shoah, who only managed to escape because he happened to be in the Soviet part of Poland and happened to be taken to a Soviet camp near leader of the Beitar movement, and ironically, or interestingly enough, that's what allowed him to escape, the fate of the rest of his family. He understood what it meant to have a Jewish state. Where never again, it's not just a slogan, it means never again. So he called the head of the Air Force and said, is there any way we can stop Iraq from building a nuclear reactor? They were literally weeks away from becoming operational, thanks to our good friends, the French, who built and supplied all the technology. And that was sarcasm. And basically, this guy called in Ilan Ramon, who was strategic planning, who went to his lonely writer's garret for a few days, so he came back and said, I have a plan, but it's mission impossible, but this is the only thing I can come up with. I suggest we take 9 F-16s, fly them 2,000 miles over enemy territory, and we specially designed bunker buster bombs. It is all designed, because America wouldn't supply them at the time. And then we'll take out the reactor, and then we'll fly back again. But the only thing is, a few slight technical issues. One is that we need to insert a command unit on the ground. People don't know it was actually a unit of Israel's Sayyid Matkal on ground in Iraq, who were actually laser guiding the planes in, which is pretty an amazing unknown fact. It was only recently released. And second of all, we can't refuel because the refueling planes have been shot on the radar. This whole mission, by the way, had to fly about 500 feet above the ground at supersonic speed. And they flew almost wingtip to wingtip, so just in case it did show up on the radar, we looked like one big airplane, not a whole bunch of fighter planes coming for us. And we probably won't have enough fuel to get back. If we do have enough fuel, we'll be literally landing on the fumes of our tanks and getting back. And one last thing you said, that wasn't enough. The last plane going in.
Other students, please come to the main office. Rebecca Weinberger, Kira Fox, Avery Bloom, Reva Kogan, and Avery to the main office.
The last plane going in is definitely the most dangerous plane because the element of supply to be lost, it's the most exposed position. And I want to volunteer to be the last plane in. So Menachem Begin and the head of the Air Force are listening to this explanation, and they thought, wow, it's crazy enough, but why do you want to volunteer to be the last plane in? The answer he gave was probably the reason why he was chosen to be Israel's first astronaut and represent the Jewish state. And this is what he said, very clearly and very succinctly. Did I come from a family of Holocaust survivors? My mother and grandmother were liberated from Auschwitz. I'm now colonel of the Israeli Air Force. Look how far we've come. 70 years ago, the star was painted yellow, to show the helplessness of the Jewish people. Today we have a blue star, and that star shows the hope of the Jewish people and the strength of the Jewish people. I want to be part of this mission because the whole point, the reason to enter the state of Israel is to prevent the Second Holocaust, to be our home, to be a refuge. And this is the way we can prevent it. I'll be part of this mission, and I'll fly that last plane in. And the rest of you know is history. It did happen. A mission happened, and against all the odds, every single plane got back safely after wiping out the nuclear reactor. And what was the response of the world? Condemnation. How dare those Jews get up and defend themselves? We don't mind going to Holocaust ceremonies when mourning the weak, poor Jews with their hands up, but how dare you have to stand up and defend themselves? Worldwide condemnation, including the Ronald Reagan bringing it up. It was a good friend of the Jewish people. He wasn't happy that he heard about it the news. What happened 10 years later when American troops invaded Iraq? There was no nuclear threat, and the head of the American troops, a guy called General Norman Schwarzkopf, going to personal land and the Israeli Air Force, David, it would be thanking Israel for the fact that American troops didn't have to deal with the possible nuclear threat. But all this is history. Years and years go by when Bill Clinton finally offered to Shimon Peres and then part of the spirit of cooperation with the United States and Israel, they would like to an astronaut, Israeli astronaut to join the American space program. No one was surprised that they chose Ilan Ramon. So Ilan Ramon was chosen for this mission. And Ilan Ramon basically was very conscious of one thing. He was conscious that he was not representing Ilan Ramon, private individual. He was conscious he was representing two types of people. A, descendants of Holocaust survivors. B, most importantly, an Israeli pilot representing the Jewish state and the Jewish people. When he went for his training in Houston, he was conscious of something else. If he's going to represent the Jewish people, his mission is not a personal mission, it's a symbolic mission. And fortunately or unfortunately, Ilan Ramon went to a public school in Israel. In Israel, there's two types of school. There's Mamlakhti, which is a public school. There's Mamlakhti Dati, which is a religious public school. If you go to a secular public school, yes, you speak Hebrew, and yes, you're pretty nationalistic and motivated, because you saw he's a part of the Air Force. But you know very little what we call in the Holy Language, Yiddishkeit. I remember being in the army, and for the first time you have this cross-pollination in Israel, where secular and religious Israelis usually meet when they're 18 for the first time. Because if you go to a secular school, the chances are all your friends are secular. If you go to a religious school, the chances are all your friends are religious. But I remember people when I was 18 who literally never met a Shomer Shabbat Jew in their lives. I remember swearing at the cartel, there was a guy from Be'er Sheva, 2 hours south of Jerusalem, and that was his first time in the cartel. Every Kutzik who goes to Israel goes to the Kotel or goes to Jerusalem. This guy was born and raised in Israel, serving in a combat unit, and he'd never been to the Kotel before, because it wasn't a priority, it wasn't important. So you get this cross-pollination. Now, Ilan Ramon was raised totally secular, totally secular. And he realized he's going to have to learn a bit about what it means to be Jewish. He actually went to classes, to the Chabad house, and became very friendly with the Chabad rabbi in Houston. You're going to introduce him in a while. And he learned Judaism 101. He also, the first time he wasn't the first Jewish astronaut. There have been Jewish astronauts before, like American Jewish astronauts. But he was the first astronaut who took kosher food from into space, even though he himself didn't actually keep kosher because of the symbolic importance of the mission. He also took many important symbolic objects with him into space as well. But most interestingly, all those objects he took with him, profound and moving objects, such as a picture by Peter Ginz, a 14-year-old, a boy who drew this picture to Wiesenstadt and was later deported and killed in Auschwitz, but his pictures survived. And he drew, and when Ilan Ramon was looking for objects to take with, he went to the art museum, Park Yad Vashem, saw this picture by this 14-year-old boy who was killed, a Czech boy, and it basically was a picture of the Earth as seen from the moon. Almost like an Imagine song of John Lennon, where here he is in the middle of a ghetto in Wiesenstadt in Czechoslovakia, and he imagines standing on the moon, just looking at the Earth, where you don't see the countries, you don't see the borders, imagines a better world and a better place. And that was a picture, nothing on the original picture, but Ilan Ramon took a copy of that picture into space, both because of his own Holocaust background, because of what that picture symbolized. He took a mezuzah was wrapped with barbed wire from Auschwitz, just to show the Jewish people kept our faith and kept our tradition. But the most important object he took with him, which you're going to see, never made it back to Earth. One object that did make it back to Earth, with a huge surprise to everyone else, was this object over here.
We'll just dim the lights a bit in the back, so it's the screen.
Was this. The shuttle exploded, as you know, 60 minutes before it landed, kilometers high in space, a huge, massive explosion, thousands of degrees of heat. And then all the debris floated down over the Texas. For months afterwards, as they tried to figure out what the cause of this explosion was, they had teams collecting all the debris to reconstruct the plane. And about 2 months afterwards, after the explosion, lying in a field months later, some scouts who were searching found a scrambled up piece of paper. It's like a clump of paper. They looked very closely and saw that what was written on wasn't in English. They thought maybe it was some type of NASA code. They sent it to NASA, and we all know the cliche about Jewish rocket scientists. They claimed there was a Jewish rocket scientist there. They realized that the scribbles were actually in Hebrew, and they were handwritten. The next thing they did, they realized it obviously belonged to Ilan Ramon, because he was the only Israeli astronaut on board, is they opened it up, and there was 18 handwritten pages from Ilan Ramon's diving through space. Again, to find this symbol, if you are, no one else had survived. Everything was ameliorated with the explosion. It was lying in the field for months, and they found 18 pages, which was very difficult to read. You could just about barely make out the Hebrew letters. That's about it. So NASA didn't have the technology. This is NASA. So they sent it to Israel, where the Israeli police lab in Tel Aviv, using all the sites you could possibly imagine, not just the printed letter, but all sorts of document recreation stuff, and they managed to recreate what he'd written on in his diary. So when it's restored, he'd actually read the Hebrew letters, and the first page of his diary, he wrote the Kiddush, the Friday night Kiddush. That's what he wrote on the first page of his diary. So the big question, of course, is why? Of all the things that you should be writing, why is he writing the words of Friday night Kiddush in his diary? Any ideas? One is very obvious, which is so obvious when you're not thinking about it. The second one is a bit more significant. He knew he would be in space, in fact, I think he'd be like 6 hours of Shabbat if you go around the world. So he obviously realized he'd be there for Shabbat. Okay, so.
He didn't know it.
He didn't know it. He didn't know the word. If anyone's FFB, you know what that stands for? Okay, yeah, full conversion. So if you're full conversion, you know all this stuff, you're all little pilot. In fact, when was the last time you were busy, like, mumbling in your tefillah? And you're like, oh, how did it get up in the middle of the Amid already? Because we just know it all, we just mumble it all, right? And so same with Friday night Kiddush, you know, because you hear it every Friday. But if you go up in a second home, you don't hear it, you don't know it. He doesn't know the words, he wrote them down. So he wanted to say it in space. Why did he want to say it in space? Because of the mission. He was representing the Jewish people. He wanted to say Friday night Kiddush in space. If you ever looked at the words, quite often we say things without knowing what they mean. That's part of not speaking pure Hebrew. The words are more powerful when said in this particular setting. They start off Yom HaShishim, like Kulo HaShemayim Ha'aretz HaKol Tzara'ah. God created the heavens and the earth and all the stars. Imagine being in the heavens, seeing the earth beneath you, surrounded by the stars, and saying that sentence. How powerful does it get? And it should send like tingles down your spine. That's what it was talking about. The getting a visual of the text. The text suddenly becomes three-dimensional. And that was the word. Now, why is this so important? Because Ilan Ramon was aware of the mission. Even the mission patch, the pouch of the mission, if you look at all the astronauts' names, everyone was a wonderful person. Humanity lost a lot with this crash. What's next to Ilan Ramon's name? Little Israeli flag. Now, if you want to see how small this patch is, I have a friend whose mom actually works in NASA, one of the controllers of the mission, who actually sent me a mission patch. This is an actual mission patch for Ilan Ramon's mission. It's a very small patch, it's what the astronauts have in their, on their suit. And it's teeny, the flag. But it's not the size that counts. I can't pass this on to you guys, good. He wanted to make a point that Israel, for him, is nothing he's embarrassed about. He's not going to hide his Israeli or Jewish identity. He wore very proudly, you'll see when you see pictures of him, the Israeli flag literally on his arm, right by his heart. Even when he wasn't wearing his astronaut uniform, you see him addressing us for space. You see how right on top of his heart he has the Israeli flag. He was in your face, Israeli and Jewish, and proud of it. And to get a cap, even to such an extent, he even wanted to have a little flag by his name. Now, 30 days after the shuttle crash, spent in that by Zvi Carnegie, was in the Shloshim in Cape Canaveral. In Houston, and they had a hesped. And he talked about why it was so important to Ilan Ramon to say Kiddush in space. So I wanted to show you this 2-minute hesped and understand what kind of person Ilan Ramon was.
Discovery is not an option we choose. It is a desire written.
10, 9, 8, 7,
Discovery is not an option we choose. It is a desire written in the human heart. We find the best among us, send them forth into unmapped darkness, and pray they will return. They go in peace for all mankind, and all mankind is in their debt.
On board Space Shuttle Columbia, Israel's first astronaut, Ilan Ramon, conducted cutting-edge scientific research together with six other crew members. Ramon took a number of Jewish artifacts with him into orbit, including a small Torah scroll that survived Bergen-Belsen. After 16 days in orbit, the space shuttle Columbia exploded on re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere. Ilan Ramon passed away in his prime, leaving a widow and four young children. Yet his legacy reminds us of our Jewish identity, no matter where we are, no matter what we're doing. Part of Ramon's diary was miraculously recovered amongst the debris scattered across Texas. 18 pages survived 5,000-degree heat, 40-mile fall to Earth at minus 700 degrees. On one page, Ramon had handwritten the prayer so that he could make Kiddush on Friday night in outer space.
I'm doing it because I feel I represent all Israelis and all of the Jewish communities.
His friend and rabbi, Zvi Konnikov, recounted.
Ilan Ramon turned to me with a question. How does one mark the Sabbath in space? With every 90 minutes, another sunset. Every 10 and a half hours is a Sabbath. Every 20 days, Rosh Hashanah. Jerusalem, we have a problem. But Ilan taught us a powerful message. No matter how fast we're going, no matter how important our work, we need to pause and think about why we're here on Earth.
How about that? It takes a second of you sometimes for us to realize the importance of Shabbat and what we do all the time, take it for granted. So, and then we saw a brief clip of what probably was the most important item he took with him to space, and that of course was the Torah. Not just any Torah. In that moment, it was going on this mission, was chosen to showcase Israeli scientific experiments. Israel, as you know, is probably cutting edge when it comes to science. This is one of the seven countries on the planet Earth that have military satellites in space. Seven, right? It's one of them, have military satellites in space. Right now in Israel, they're actually trying desperately to win that Google prize of $50 million to have the first unmanned object land on the moon. They're pretty close, they're about a year away from it, but they're racing a few other many countries as well, South Korea and Russia and all these other countries. It's a Google Prize. But so he went to Tel Aviv University to speak to one of the professors about the experiment that he was taking with him, which is called the MIDEX experiment. It's an experiment to conduct research into climate change from space, which is much more, it's much easier to do it from space. So he went into this professor's room. His name was Professor Yosef Yoyachim. And he's very, very University of Tel Aviv type. I've been to the University of Tel Aviv, my wife studied medicine there, and it's extremely secular. It's probably the only place I've been to where the shul had a sign outside saying, this synagogue is closed on the Sabbath and Jewish holidays. it's Tel Aviv University. So he goes into this guy's room, and he sees, obviously not wearing a kippah, and I don't want to wear a kippah. He saw there was a little cupboard behind his desk. It looked like a little cupboard. And he said, what's inside there? And the guy opened it up. And this wasn't part of why he went to see him. There's a little Torah scroll inside. He's thinking, why is a teeny Torah scroll in this professor's office? So the guy told him the story. He had a funny accent, kind of like you guys. And he said, listen, I was originally from Holland. I came here to Israel after the war. But during the war, we were taken, like all Dutch Jews, to Westerbork and later on to Bergen-Belsen. And I was just about to be 13. I was just before my bar mitzvah when we were taken to Bergen-Belsen. And there was a rabbi of a small Dutch town called Groningen, northern Holland, who was also in this camp as well. And he came up to me just before, it was supposed to be a bar mitzvah, I don't know how he knew, and said, how would I like to read my parasha from the Torah. And what he's talking about is Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. And this rabbi had smuggled in a teaspoon of wine into the camp. He heard it was his child bombing, so he asked, I'm glad to do it. I'd like to read it. He said, of course. And against all the odds, almost surreal, sometimes the truth is less strange than reality. We can't even make this stuff up. They organized it. He learned to read his parashah from his teenage Torah in Bergen-Belsen. And when the day actually came of his bar mitzvah, they got up earlier, put windows on, put blankets on the windows of their barracks, and just before he's about to start reading, there was a knock on the door, and they thought that someone had actually tripped off the camp guard. But instead, again, against all the odds, this is a phenomenal story, somehow they got his mother from the mother's camp, through the camp underground, and she came in, and that was where she heard the bar mitzvah, and that's where they also saw each other for the last time as well. And at the end of the ceremony, the rabbi gave the boy the Torah and said, listen, I'm going to help you survive this camp. You might, you're young, you have a life ahead of you. If you survive, I'll just take this Torah and make a promise. You'll tell the Lord what happened here. You'll tell the Lord what happened here, and you'll tell the Lord how important it is to carry on religion in our faith. Do you promise? He said, oh boy, this 13-year-old boy didn't know what else to do. He took the Torah and promise. And against the odds, he did survive. He came to his own and the Abed ship. He served in the IDF as an officer. And years later, decades later, he had this Torah sitting in his room in University of Tel Aviv when Ilan Ramon walked in. Ilan Ramon was just blown away by the story. He went back and told his wife what he just heard, and never mind the mid-deck science experiment. He just heard this unbelievable story. And then he went back the next day with a stranger to Christ and he wanted to take that Torah to space. And the professor thought, not long and hard about it, he thought, wow, who would have thought all these years later, finding it a chance to perform my promise to Abba, where billions of people will see this Torah in space. Billions of people will see that all I got here, the life of the nations, the Jewish people, what we've done to make the world a better place. And he gave to another mom with his blessing. Last year, PBS made a film called Mission of Hope. Did anybody see the film? Okay, I'll show you a short clip from it soon. Of course, I'll show you everything. And this film basically is a phenomenal. You can get it, you can order it. You know, and I just ordered it online. We're going to PBS side, Mission of Hope. It's a really amazing documentary about this whole mission. And this film interviewed the professor, interviewed Ron Ramon. It was just a phenomenal film about Ilan's life, what he lived for. The first one, I wanted to show you the actual trailer of it, and then I'm going to show you the segment when he actually takes the Torah out into space and what he says when he's holding it. Lights.
Light.
How do you get it? How do you get it?
In the bottom. Bottom.
The nation's grief, the Columbia's lost. On board was a crew of seven.
February 1st, the final day of Columbia, in a very unbelievable manner, closed another circle.
Efforts to recover debris continue.
Ilan Ramon, first Israeli to fly in space, was on board this mission.
Would be separated from our parents. We were put on a cattle train, doors were locked. We said hello, we said goodbye. The rabbi of the people in the camp, he said, well, promise me that you will tell the story. What happened here? He pressed this Torah into my hands, and I looked at him and said, okay, I promise.
This is the
Israel world famous astronaut, I would like to ask you to give me to take to space.
He told me I am the representative of all the people of Israel.
He thought he would show it to the world as a symbol of how a person can go from the depth of hell to the heights of space.
Our pride, our hope will accompany me, and it will
noticed that the title of this presentation was called The Torah in Space. And of all the articles that Ilan Ramon took written, he took many other articles were written as well. Flag, the Titan Alpha microfilm, the whole slew of different articles. Kids' pictures, all sorts of things. He took different personal things, religious articles, Zionistic articles. But the Torah speaks the most to all of us. One of the questions that Samuel Longhorn Clements, otherwise known as Mark Twain, asked when he traveled around the world in the 19th century and saw these ruined civilizations and Jewish communities still thriving, he asked the question, what is the secret of his immortality? What did the Jews do right that everyone else did wrong? Imagine 2,000 years ago, you went back in time as the Romans were destroying the Beit HaMikdash, and you tapped a soldier on his shoulder, say that one passed, and said, in 2,000 years' time, this temple was destroyed, the Jews will be back here, won't be speaking Hebrew, they'll be part of the state of Israel, unless you follow what the United Nations has to say about it. And the Romans would be dispersed in ashes. What would that soldier have done? He would have laughed, and he would have given you a smiley face in your neck with his sword. But he would have thought it would be possible. Yet it is possible. And Ilan Ramon's mission symbolized what the Jews did right there, but after wrong. The secrets of Jewish survival, against all the odds, without physically being in ownership of our own country, far away from our land, against strange mission, the Jewish people, man, not to survive, but to thrive. They did three things. Ilan Ramon symbolizes all these three things. One, what do we never lose? The three things. The Torah, about our tradition, right? So you've got tradition, what are the other two things? You see how it symbolizes all these things, what? What? Okay, we've got the hope, which I'm going to finish with, and also the sense of community. When Ilan Ramon went up, I'm sure everyone remembers it, right? We thought that's one of ours. Even if you're Israeli and not Israeli, in fact, when he was Jewish, he thought, wow, Kol Yisrael Achim, right? We're all brothers, we're all sisters, we're all responsible for each other. The sense of community, the sense of family. If anyone travels, it doesn't matter which country and what language they speak, you just have to go to Beit Knesset and you feel you're amongst your family, not your people, right? Hachnasa Dorkim, Pidyon Shurim, all these wonderful things that preserve our sense of community. The community and faith is not enough. Without, as Lady the Back mentioned, the Tikvah, the Shi'ifah Letzion. Wherever Jews lived, they always had a yearning for Zion. They always knew they weren't at home. The good times, the bad times, they always knew they weren't at home. When the happiest moments of your life are a chuppah, that you make a bad mistake, and you break the glass and you say, Ebus Kerech Yerushalayim, right before you get smashed, you smash the glass. When you go into any Beit Knesset, you're always facing Yerushalayim. Levim and Israel, our heart are always in the East. We know where our home is. Our whole religion is Israel-centric. A religion about yearning, about going back, and one day that hope will be fulfilled. It has been fulfilled. And Ilan Ramon symbolized all these three things. The sense of community, the sense of one of ours went up, that's one of our boys, right? The sense of whatever an Israeli soldier is lost, we feel like it's our own son, our own daughter that's been lost. Just tremendous, when you're in Israel, you feel like you're part of your own large Jewish family. You can travel and tour any other country in the world, but only in Israel you feel at home. Why? Because it is our home. Home is where the heart is. And most importantly, this particular Torah that he took up. This was not just any Torah, this was a Torah that actually been in and out of concentration camp and ended up in Israel, like a phoenix arising from the ashes, like the Jewish people themselves. And he went up, and I wanted to show you this clip now from the actual film, from reading what he says. Now, Ilan Ramon was so beautiful in this clip. He was a pilot, he was an astronaut, but he made the decision when he was holding the Torah in space and showing it to the world, to billions of people, what he wanted to say in Hebrew. Because Hebrew is our language, it's a Jewish language. Don't worry, it's a translation of the Bible. Most poignantly, as you'll see in this very, very small clip, the daughters of the rabbi are still alive. They survived. Their father did, but they survived. And you hear their reaction to see their father's Torah held up in space decades after they lost their father. And you hear the action of Rona Ramon, the widow of Ilan Ramon, how important it was to Ilan to take this Torah up in space. But most importantly, you'll hear the words he chooses to say when he's holding this Torah, and why does he want to take a Torah and show it to the world. So let's check this out in the actual film itself.
We've got a great picture here of
the pad green is always the better compass around it. In case you wonder where your JNF trees are, you can see very clearly in space. But they don't have your name on them.
Jerusalem, this is Houston. Please call Columbia for a voice check.
I would like to invite you to visit us here. I can assure you that you will find yourself among friends.
Thank you very much. We really appreciate the invitation.
Ilan said, I thought about this very much. I would like to ask you to give me this little Torah to take to space.
You realize the potential of this wonderful story of the Torah.
There was Ilan. There we saw him holding the Torah scroll. For a minute, it escaped from his hand and kind of floated, and he caught it.
אני חשבתי שזה דרישת שלום. מן השמיים. סימן חיים. מן האבא.
I see it as a sort of a rising of the dead of my father. He came alive again.
אז
he thought he would show it to the world as a symbol of how a person can go from the depth of hell to the heights of space. I had finally fulfilled my promise to Rabbi Simon Tasberg in a way I wish I would never have thought it would be possible.
I think it was the most important thing for Ilan to show the world and to be in a position to expose this amazing story of surviving.
There are two dimensions. There is a sky and there is a heaven. The sky is a matter of height. A heaven is a matter of depth. It is a combination of penetrating the skies and demonstrating the values of the heaven. And I think Ilan Ramon, who has had an eye for the depth, really created an unforgettable power.
You go in there, you see the candles, you hear the names, you stand long enough, you probably hear your own people name as well. And you think, wow, there look the grace of God go on. I thought that I loved my life 70 years ago, but I'm alive today. And just before you go in, there's a very small pasuk. Nobody noticed it. It says, there Hashem Nishmat Adam. It's written just above the entrance before you go inside the memorial. Which means the candle of God is the soul of every man. We all have a tremendous potential to light up the world with our own little light. All those candles are sort of a warrior as well. Ilan Ramon might be gone, but his light, his image, his message is what still lights our way to the future as well. And I want to finish actually with his own words. He reminds us of three things. He reminds us of what kept us Jewish, our tradition, our community, our connection to Israel. That's what kept us Jewish. And as he pointed that time to space, he said the following. He said, my mission symbolizes more than anything else the ability of the Jewish people to survive everything, including horrible periods, and go from the darkest days to days of hope and faith in the future. And that is the message that he sent. Again, in Judaism, it doesn't matter how long you live your life, it matters what you do with the life that you live. And I'm the one that lived a full life, and he lived a life of hope, and a life of meaning, and most importantly, he lived by the personal example. And he died the way that he lived, by leading, and teaching us, and being a light, and just as he was a light to us, so the state that he represented, our state, the state of Israel, carried on being all the way. Questions, or are we good to go? Yes.
In addition to going to Israel, which
what's your name?
I'm Patty. In addition to going to Israel and educating the next generation, are there other things that you can be able to do from Kutzla Arts that would be helpful or supportive?
As Patty asked a question, what we can do. I tell you what we can't do, right? We can't be silent. We've seen in our history what happens when Jews are silent. That's one thing we can't be. And we can't be embarrassed either. We're not going to take down our Israeli flags or take our people out of our. We're going to be proud and embrace Jews. That's what we can. That's the two things we're not doing. So what can we do? There's basically four things you can do. One, the most important thing is to fulfill that first principle, not just to talk the talk, but to walk the walk, and make sure that you and your children go to Israel sooner the better. The first thing I did when this broke out was I read books for us to go and journey to Israel. That was my idea, is to go to Israel. This only does a reading as well. The second thing, of course, is to be educated, to be informed, and to spread it around, not to you guys, not to be teaching to the choir, right? There's very few of you all love Israel, your kids all go to day school. But what about the other 80% that's totally clueless? So whether you're using social media, it's knowledge is power. That's the second thing you can use, to be informed and make sure that people who need to get the real picture before the future. And of course, we can also be leaders as well by joining and actively taking part in the Federation and all sorts of other things that are around there, being leaders in your own community, and most importantly, of course, to the United Nations, just like our countries as well, but we live our lives. We need to remind people that we're not going to shrink away like the Jews did in the Holocaust, the Jews of America. We weren't very active. They made up into the Soviet Jewry movement. But also now as well, we need to get out, we need to go to every demonstration we can hear, we need to write to the newspapers, and basically the worst thing you can do is to do nothing. Passive Judaism is an oxymoron. To do is to do is to get up there and to be educated, to be proud, to be out there, and to educate others as well, and that's what we can do.
Do you speak to the kids versus us parents? Pardon? Do you speak to the kids also?
I think it's only 11th grade kids. I do a 12th grade elective, I'll be twice a week. I also do assemblies as well, and the curriculum that the school's using, actually wrote. So this is a curriculum they're using, it's called the same design. It's used in day schools throughout Australia and many United States and Canada. And every single 11th grade student, 12th grade elective student, will get this curriculum. It's actually just waiting out for this one before the vision coming out. We're actually teaching in this curriculum. And it includes not just topics, but also role models. So for example, one of the role models they're learning about is Ilan Ramon. And so they do get to hear about, they do get to hear from me as well. This is actually an exception. You have a seminar class with the parents. At least when I'm here, I'm speaking to the students. Pardon? I was just in a hill now in Minnesota yesterday. What? Lovely, that's why I'm my doctorate. I know about it. Don't worry, I've spent plenty of times there. Yeah. But when I'm avoiding all the anti-Israel demonstrations on the way to class, I talk plenty of times. I talk a lot of the place. Yeah, I guide, I've been working with Birdlife for the last 16 years, and what we're doing is I'm a tour guide. And I spoke on campus in Canada, the United States, Australia, South Africa, Great Britain, and I talk about the world in the campuses. Because most of the, you get three kinds of kids on campus. Campus and the love Israel, like you guys. And then Israel's got problems, but they can love Israel anyway. You get 10% of people that hate Israel, it's irrational, like it's anti-Semitism, they just can't call it that because of the Holocaust. And no matter what you say or do, they're still going to hate you. So you just let the haters hate, or if you want to say something, they're going to say it to you. But there's nothing else to say. But the real reason I go to campus is the 80% of people in the room, including many clueless Jews. And my wife and I went to the University of Pennsylvania, which is 40% Jewish in the Democratic population, and the level of ignorance is mind-boggling. So that's who we're actually going for, the 80% that are clueless. Jews for Justice in Palestine, J Street, all those kind of organizations. And usually people join them because they're ignorant. And part of what I do on campus is educate that 80%.
And the problem is, I don't want to, I actually have to go myself, but especially college students who are intelligent enough, they don't buy the rah-rah.
I'm not going to Ilan Ramon on them, but I think it's very, very different things. Yesterday I gave a talk in the University of Minnesota on the morality and ethics of the idea. It's a very different type of talk. What exactly is a war crime? What is proportionality? These are things that you have to know your audience.
We know other differences between this generation. We all grew up, you know, there was no such thing as a house. There was a myth, there was this, we have thought about this. Today, this is reality, and a lot of Jewish
What I'm telling you, what I had no clue there was. Also, when you grow up, it's obvious what Jewish they are. But it's a little bit different. It's more nuanced, and I never ever treat them as a Jewish. And I'm here to refresh.
Especially for the old kids,
and especially,
you know, is really also something, is more nuanced.
Well, I'm teaching it, so I
can
say that it is.
Okay. Because otherwise these kids
are going
to sit there and say, okay,
well,
I've heard this, I know what you're saying,
great, but... I know some men and girls, I'll give you a quick example of that. When people say, is this all apartheid state? The quick thing, they know, of course it's not, because Israel has to be broken down representation. But it's not a simple answer. Because if you look at George Orwell's Animal Farm, you see, yes, more equal, but some are more equal than others.
Correct.
Yes, Israeli Arabs don't serve the Amish for restriction. Yes, their villages do get less scrubbing than the Jewish villages. It's not a simple yes or no answer. And that's the way that I teach it. All the nuance that we train.
Because
Israel is struggling and wrestling with many issues.
This is what we did last year, which was amazing. We did a program last year for the seniors that Rachel was down with us. It was like a half-day workshop where Shachar got up first and talked about the pain and suffering and explained what that narrative is, asked what did you say, and there was not one kid who was able to give an answer that would resonate to anybody on campus. Then he showed the John Stewart film that was incredibly biased from the Gaza War, asked them to articulate what did he do. So the kids saw what the strategies were, then told them some of the strategies that he could use of using language like Can You Imagine, had the kids give examples of how to use Can You Imagine. Then the kids broke up into groups of three different topics, in groups of four, and they were told in 2 hours you could present the equivalent of a TED Talk on one of these topics, responsible to BDS, showing the positive Israel, or the UN. At the end of the 2 hours, they broke up into groups, rooms with four groups, each doing a presentation with a response. It was mind-boggling what the kids did. One of them was the students went to the computer and took out a comparison of computer printout of the New York subway tunnel system and the Gaza tunnel system. And how do you compare society of how they use tunnels for other purposes? But was, and it was not even strongly stone group. It was, but the idea was that the kids did a project-based assignment where we're not dictating what to do, but what it is that they could use. They were supposed to be materials and they were supposed to sell them if they know that they could go through. And working with Tuvia was down to us, the Frisch's pilot last year, to take 10 schools in the New York area, to work with our senior with Tuvia to figure out what are the best prompts that this can be a pilot to go elsewhere. And the goal is that it's not the first thing. There's no competition. Does Frisch do it better than SAR or Ramaz? No, we have to put that aside. There has to be some common project that the kids all over the metropolitan area are working on without defining what it is and having to use positive language in dealing with this issue. And that the kids feel that they know what to do, that they can tackle it. Because no matter how good the education is, unless they feel that they can use it, they're not going to be able to be successful. So the idea is to somehow work together. So anybody who's interested in talking to me more about it, we also want there to be community liaison working with it so that it's not the kids in isolation, but there's a community momentum of giving kids up to the kids that this is something that they should take passionately, the same way Frisch transformed Sharia, that they become passionate about the Jewish identity through Sharia, that they should become connected to articulate it.
Okay. I just want to meet you. This is Torah. This is by Torah.